You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
At a cursed crossroads where souls collide, see the prince of darkness, see the prince of lies, while the world lies sleeping and the moon's aglow. There you may meet with the devil, you know, when your heart is quaking and your soul can't rest. Open up the pages of the devil you know best. People face their demons as each tale unfolds, but the devil's in the details, and their fate's been sold. Hear their fate's been sold, and they're lost to hell. That's the deal you have to make with the devil you know well.
Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Be sure to connect with us on social media and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss our next broadcast. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
Here we go. Welcome to the program, ladies and gentlemen. We are live from the bunker. How do we sound today? I can't hear myself very well. It's not one thing, it's another. Welcome, everybody. We are broadcasting to YouTube, Odyssey, and Rumble live, which means the live chat widget is open. My name is Jason Hunt. I am the editor here at Sci-Fi for Me. Glad to have all of you with us. And if you're here live, jump in the chat. If you're not with us live, you can still leave a comment. Email address livefromthebunker@scififorme.com. And of course, all the socials, the Discord, all that good stuff. So do check all of that out and connect with us. I don't want that one. I want this one. Sci-Fi Snob says, I came for the Dune review. Mazer says, hearing okay, sounds fine. Snob says, Mazer has a deep thought of the day. Isn't it funny how there's such a positivity push today, now more than ever, but we don't appear to be teaching respect to both of the self and others? That's a deep thought. That's a deep thought, Mazer. So I'm going to have to think about that one. A Dune review is coming. We saw Dune Part 2 last night. Mrs. Boss is currently in a video conference call for work, but she's going to be writing the review for us. And I will say this for the most. I'll wait till she's available so we can actually get into a conversation about this. But I enjoyed the film. I did not enjoy the experience of watching the film last night. They threw us into an IMAX theater, and the sound mix was atrociously bad. And it really took away from my enjoyment of the experience. The movie itself, craft-wise and all this other, the movie itself is good. I enjoyed the movie. I did not enjoy watching the movie. Because the mix was so off. The sound effects and the music were just overpowering, and it was not fun for me. But I'm old. I'm a curmudgeon. I like things just so. I don't like going into IMAX, but anyway. Okay. So we've got a lot of stuff to go through today. Before the second hour, Harry Turtledove will be here the second hour, as far as I know. What? Oh, you're still over there. You're not talking to me. All right. Keely's here in the chat. Good to see you as well. By the way, okay, so coming out of my discussion with David Levine yesterday, and I don't know if this is a odd coincidence or what, but the ChatGPT apparently has had an aneurysm because, and people are posting all sorts of screen grabs on this stuff. Apparently, it started speaking in Spanglish and then went to gibberish. This is Sean McGuire posting over on Twitter. These are just some screen grabs. The entire thread on this is full of this kind of stuff. People asking ChatGPT, did you have a stroke? And it's just spewing a bunch of nonsense. Absolute nonsense. ChatGPT-4. And it's, look at this. This edit is, here it 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 is. I mean, what is this? ChatGPT is losing its mind. And I'm absolutely here for it, folks. this is just something, because OpenAI. OpenAI says they've identified the problem, and they're investigating it. But my goodness, see, you think just when you get to where you can trust the technology, it turns around and betrays you. I mean, this is how Skynet happens, right? Exactly. Cam's right. Get ready for the nuke launch. That's right. My goodness. I tell you, it's just, I'm absolutely here for it. Let's just do it. It is so much fun to watch this. Oh, man. Okay. Anyway, so that's going on. Well, and that's how we get to the world of Borderlands, right? You guys see, we got a new trailer. We got a trailer. Yeah, Snob says, as it becomes human, it goes insane. Yes. Well, okay, so we have the Borderlands trailer. And it's interesting to note, this movie has been in development for a very, very, very long time. An extremely long time. Scott Pitlick reminds us the Borderlands movie was announced at PAX West 2015. This is almost 8 years ago. He says he wrote the press release for it. He says, I remember how excited everyone at GBX, Lionsgate, and 2K was celebrating at a party after the big GBX panel. Now we finally have the first trailer. Almost 8.5 years later. And there's some discussion online. Have we missed the window for Borderlands? Is anybody excited about seeing this movie? Is anybody ready to see it? Is this a movie that... I mean, I don't know the game. I'm not familiar with the game at all. I know of it. I recognize the aesthetic of it. I recognize some of the characters that are here in this thing. But, you know, there's Jamie Lee Curtis, and we've got, we've got the guy in the mask. You know, it says here, from the producers of Uncharted, Spider-Man, and Venom, Aria Rod. There's, Cate Blanchett as Lilith, and it looks fun, and the trailer uses REO Speedwagon's "Do Ya" as the music track, and of course it's very very Guardians of the Galaxy ish in its tone, kind of comedy, action comedy, whatever. But are we 8 years too late for this movie? Is anybody wanting to see this movie? That's my question, because I don't know. Honestly, I really don't know. And can we do without the trailer starts now and then the trailer starts? Can we just start the trailer? When did this start? I don't remember exactly when this started, because we had trailers. Back in the day, there were trailers, and we had, the trailer for the movie, it would come out, and if it was, when we got to the online thing, the trailer would just drop, and it'd be on wherever you found it, whether it was Joe Blow or the studio channel or wherever. And then we got teasers for the trailers. So the trailer would get scheduled, and we don't. The trailer's coming Thursday. But Monday, we would get these little snippets, this little 15-second thing that teased the trailer. And I remember at the time when that started, I thought, who the heck thought this up? This is, I get it from a marketing standpoint. Remember, 38 years, professional broadcaster. I get it. But it's a dumb idea, and it's extra work, and why? If you're gonna do that, then just drop the trailer. And then you have, as if nobody really understands, hey, here's the trailer. You put a little announcement at the beginning. The trailer starts now, and then you start the trailer. Well, if I'm going to watch the trailer, I hit play. I know the trailer starts now. The trailer starts when I hit play. That's now. Now I hit play, the trailer starts. I don't need to be told in the trailer that the trailer starts. Why? 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 Why do this? All right, so I'm just gonna show the video. That I'm not gonna play the sound, because I don't want to get dinged, because that happens. Jack Black is doing the voice of Claptrap the robot. You got Kevin Hart there. You got Jamie Lee Curtis playing Tannis, and you've got Cate Blanchett as Lilith, and they're going on a treasure hunt to this planet that is the worst zombie apocalypse nightmare fueled planet ever. And there's a dragon. Mrs. Boss was asking about a dragon the other day on something, and here it is. Here's a dragon in this movie. And visually, it looks pretty good. It looks interesting to me. It looks, I'm getting Mad Max vibes. I'm getting What's the one that Anthony Mackie was just in with the clown that was also based on a thing? He was a courier driver. What was that called? RV Life says, this is the tease for my brilliant comment coming later. Stay tuned. are you off your call?
I'm off my call.
Okay, we'll talk Dune in a minute. So here, it looks good. Let's see. Fallout kind of looks the same. But that Twisted Metal, thank you, Keely. Twisted Metal, that's the one that Anthony Mackie's in where he's a delivery driver, has to cross the wasteland of the world. It's same kind of thing. There's another movie out there that I was thinking about when I saw this. Not besides the Mad Max stuff, there was another one. You've got the Guardians of the Galaxy tone. You have the Mad Max post-apocalyptic aesthetic. What's that movie that Barbed Wire, Tank Girl? Those kinds of things. Same kind of aesthetic they're gonna get in here. And then you've got this giant dragon. And they spoil a piece right here with this shot. And you're gonna have that in the very first trailer. But it looks interesting, maybe. Kinda. I don't know. Mrs. Boss, are you ready to talk Dune?
Yeah, I'm just letting you know that Mom's gonna be here in a few to pick up some stuff.
You're not in your where
yeah,
you,
I'm
you
over here. I'm
okay.
I'm finishing up.
Anyway, so there's the trailer. I'm not gonna play the audio. It's out, it's on the Lionsgate Movies website. Why am I not subscribed to that channel yet? Lionsgate Movies is the channel where you can find it and watch it. So, yeah. Meanwhile, because I was talking about ChatGPT losing its mind, we have casting news on a movie that might kind of be doing something similar. Natasha Lyonne and Simon Baker join 3000 Pictures' Clara and the Sun adaptation. This is exclusive to Deadline. As production is about to begin on 3000 Pictures' adaptation of Clara and the Sun, directed by Oscar winner Taika Waititi, Natasha Lyonne and Simon Baker have rounded out the cast, led by Jenna Ortega, playing the titular character, Academy Award-nominated actress Amy Adams, Mia Thaurya, and Aaron Murphy also star in the film, eyeing a fall theatrical release. This film is based on Kazuo Ishiguro's New York Times best-selling novel, is being produced by Heyday Films' David Heyman, Garrett Bash, and Waititi. Ishiguro will also executive produce, all the production credits there.
I'm going to go put Mom's stuff out so she can grab it. That way I don't have to go anywhere when she gets here.
Yeah, that's whatever. The novel tells the story of Clara, played by Ortega, an artificial friend designed to prevent loneliness. Clara is purchased by a mother, played by Amy Adams, and a bright teen named Josie Thuria, who adores her new robot companion but suffers from a mysterious illness. This is the story of Clara's quest to save Josie and those who love her from heartbreak, and how in the process, Clara learns the power of human love. Lyonne will play the shopkeeper, and Baker will play Josie's dad. The novel, published in March 2021 by Alfred A. Knopf in the U.S. and Faber in the U.K., debuted on the New York Times bestsellers hardcover fiction list at number 3. So, we have cast. I find it interesting that we're getting casting announcements so late anymore in the process of production. Used to be you'd get the cast announcement and then you know who was in the movie. And now it seems like we have to keep everything a secret. I mean, nobody knew that Anya Taylor-Joy was in Dune 2 until she showed up at the premiere in London. By the way, it is speculated, I've seen speculation on what character Anya Taylor-Joy is playing. And there has been a lot of discussion online about Denis Villeneuve's comments regarding Shani, Zendaya's character. Let me reassure you, Shani does not girl boss this movie. It is very much still Paul's story. And we have Florence Pugh coming in as Princess Irulan, and you have Rebecca Ferguson as Jessica Atreides, Paul's mom. And they do have more to do in this film, but it is not a girl boss change. And Mrs. Boss can address that a little bit more. It doesn't become Zendaya's movie. I'll say that. So we're getting that. So we'll talk about that in a minute. Here's another thing. Because you talk about the aesthetic of the Borderlands movie. There is this from Yuki Demers, who is an artist, production guy. 5 months ago, Patrick Harpin walked into Warner Brothers Pictures, DC, and pitched a Batman Beyond animated feature. Before we pitch, they warned us. Now, these are the people who I believe are involved in the Across the Spider-Verse Miles Morales animated stuff. Before we pitch, they warned us there is absolutely no way we can do a Beyond movie, but they loved our enthusiasm. We pitched the outline for the entire film, and what started as a never turned into a maybe. In the time since, we've been pitching our way up the company, hoping to get to James Gunn, but for now, here's a taste of what we've been cooking. So, writer-director Patrick Harpin, my dad the bounty hunter, production designer and producer Yuki Demers from Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. These are concept art that they pitched for a Batman Beyond animated movie. And I gotta say, this looks pretty slick. This works for the aesthetic, for the visuals. Who knows if we'll ever get it. But it absolutely works, I think. Meanwhile, how many Batman reboots are we going to get? Right? Snob says the same thing. Batman Beyond could be good. Better than rebooting Batman again. Batman Beyond is a continuation of the animated Batman series of the 90s. So the first animated Batman where we got Kevin Conroy when he first started playing Batman for the animated series, Batman the Animated Series. And then the New Adventures of Batman, and then Justice League Unlimited, and various different animated pictures after that. And Batman Beyond was a continuation of that. It was set further down in the future. Older Bruce Wayne has since retired from being a Batman because of his heart. And Terry McGinnis, teenager, becomes the new Batman. And it was pretty good. A lot of people liked it. A lot of people loved it. And a lot of people thought that as we were getting Michael Keaton coming back as Bruce Wayne Batman in The Flash and Batgirl, a lot of people were wondering, could we be getting a live-action Batman Beyond? Because that would totally work. You put Michael Keaton in the role of older Bruce Wayne as the mentor to Terry McGinnis's Batman. That would rock. Yeah. Snob says it's got to be future Gotham and alternate future Gotham with near future tech. Yeah, that's... Cam says, why would they ever do that? Yeah, hey, look, it worked as an animated picture. I don't know if it would work as a live action, but I think Keaton could pull it off. Okay, Cam. I've only had two cups of coffee, so... I think they could do a Batman Beyond movie. Whether it's live action or animated, there's potential there because Batman Beyond had a very, very, very energetic following. Those fans were extremely enthusiastic when that show was on. And past, you know, even today, there are very enthusiastic fans of that show. And James Gunn and Peter Safran have an opportunity because they haven't done anything yet in this new DC universe. Don't forget, The Flash is old stuff. The Flash was Snyderverse, and it was too far into the pipeline to get rid of it. Same for Aquaman and The Lost World. That stuff's not James Gunn and Peter Safran's universe. So they have an opportunity here to sit and go, you know what? Batman Beyond animated picture is not a bad idea. And if this guy's right and they went from a never to a maybe, then maybe if there's enough social media chatter online from this concept art getting dropped, maybe the people at Warner Brothers and DC sit there and go, well, you know, maybe there's an audience for this. And it's set far enough in the future that it wouldn't necessarily complicate the continuity of whatever it is they're trying to do with the other films. Maybe. Just saying. Meanwhile, over at Marvel, somebody finally woke up, it looks like. This is a Hollywood Reporter, Boris Kitt, Aaron Couch again. How Marvel is quietly retooling amid superhero fatigue. Folks, let me let you in on a secret here. There is no superhero fatigue. The fatigue is crappy story fatigue, if anything. We're tired of crap movies. We're tired of crap TV shows. We're tired of stuff that doesn't entertain us because it's not written well. It's not directed well. You don't have any good understanding of the source material, writers. And as I was saying before, I've said this before, Marvel has an opportunity to turn this thing around. And Chris Gore was right. As soon as you try to start turning Marvel and Star Wars into girl brands, you lose the plot. And maybe somebody at Marvel has finally figured that out. Hollywood Reporter, just over a year ago, Ant-Man and the Wasp, Quantumania, was set to take Marvel Studios to the next level. Oh, I guess I should pull this up so you can see it. A new villain was going to be introduced, setting the stage for several years worth of storytelling. And the movie itself was a giant sizing of a franchise that was previously modest in scope. Excuse me. Instead, the Peyton Reed-directed movie heralded a year's worth of missteps, box office blunders, and PR nightmares. It was all uncharted territory for Marvel, which had steadily been generating box office gold for 15 years. But the Disney division is in the midst of a pretty darn good February, all things considered, despite the general gloom that surrounds the superhero genre as of late. The Super Bowl trailer for Deadpool and Wolverine became the most watched trailer of all time, with 365 million views in 24 hours. Now, here's the telling part of that. Disney's math includes the 123 million people who tuned in for the game, which included just 30 seconds of the trailer. So that 365 million people who saw the trailer, that's a lie. That's marketing spin. 365 million people may have seen a part of the trailer, but the actual math, if you subtract 123 from 365, that's what, 242? So 240. Now, the trailer was on Ryan Reynolds' YouTube channel. And it hit a million like that. I mean, it just went gold. Just gonzo. But for Disney to sit there and go, yeah, 365 million people saw it. That's not true. It's kind of true. But it's deceptive in its creative use of the truth, let's say. Because if I see 30 seconds of a 3-minute trailer, I've seen a part of the trailer, but I haven't actually seen the trailer. I've seen part of it. So technically, I've seen the trailer. I just haven't seen all of the trailer. Anyway. Super Bowl fudging or not, the clip's reach was an encouraging number for a studio whose last movie, The Marvels, became the lowest grossing in the MCU's 33-film run, hitting just $206 million globally. Next came the Valentine's Day unveiling of the cast of The Fantastic Four. Pedro Pascal, Vanessa Kirby, Eben Moss-Bachrock, and Joseph Quinn, coupled with the retro art teasing a 1960s setting for the movie. And it goes on to say who the Fantastic Four is. At least they understand who the Fantastic Four is. A day later, Marvel launched the trailer for X-Men 97, a revival of the 1990s cartoon that debuts in March. And I have said this is an opportunity. If they get it right. The trailer set an internal Disney record as the biggest launch for an animated series on Disney Plus, ahead of other Marvel shows such as What If? And any animated Star Wars series. By the way, first three episodes of the final season of Bad Batch are live on Disney Plus now.
Did they drop all three of them at the same time?
They dropped the first three episodes today, yes. Because they need those watch minutes. They've got to have the watch minutes. Because just like we were talking, they fudge the numbers. They always fudge the numbers.
Well, sit there and don't charge me an extra $7 a month. And maybe I... I'm not going to go there.
All right, let me get through this. We'll talk, too.
Okay.
These public-facing moves come as studio boss Kevin Feige recalibrates the creative direction behind the scenes. Early in February, the company completed reshoots for Agatha Darkhold Diaries. Is that what we're calling it now? The WandaVision spinoff starring Katherine Hahn that is expected to hit Disney Plus this fall. The company, see, the other thing is they're reshooting everything. They're reshooting Deadpool, they're reshooting Agatha, they're reshooting Captain Falcon, World Economic Forum. They're reshooting everything. There has to be somebody higher than Kevin Feige who said, fix this, Kevin. The company usually budgets 5 days of reshoots into the schedule, but the studio completed the work in just one, fueling a sunny outlook around the show internally, according to sources associated with the series. The studio also quietly hired Eric Pearson to polish the script for Fantastic Four, so rewrite, which will shoot this summer in London. Pearson is a company stalwart who work on Thor, Ragnarok, and Black Widow, and has a reputation for taking projects over the finish line. The stakes for that movie are high, as the studio is still searching for characters and actors who can carry its universe forward after the exits of Robert Downey Jr. and Chris Evans, and the potential prison time for Jonathan Majors. Marvel also hired Joanna Kahlo, the showrunner of acclaimed FX series The Bear, to work on the script for Thunderbolts. Hollywood reporters learned the film will begin shooting in March in Atlanta. Her hiring adds a flair of prestige to the project, which stars Florence Pugh, and according to a source who has read previous drafts of the script, centers on villains and antiheroes going on a mission that was supposed to end with their deaths. Okay, Thunderbolts is... that's a reasonably accurate description of that team. Marvel is also cleaning up the creative mess left in the wake of Jonathan Majors, the once-rising actor cast to play the linchpin villain role in the next Avengers movies, but who in December was found guilty of reckless assault in the third degree and harassment in a Manhattan court after a domestic incident with his partner, ex-partner, a movement coach he met while working on Ant-Man and the Wasp: Quantumania. On the TV side, Marvel has been reorganizing its operations to allow for greater control from showrunners. A move made after the critical failure of the expensive Samuel L. Jackson spy series Secret Invasion, which sidelined executive producer Kyle Bradstreet after a year, with various creative factions vying for influence in his wake. The show had about 2.5 billion minutes of viewing over its 6 weeks run, per Nielsen, and the bottom third of Marvel's live-action Disney Plus offerings so far. The focus is internal this year, says one insider, of all the tinkering going on behind the scenes. Executives are not calling it a reboot, not even a soft one, but more of a creative retooling. So it's a reset button. It's no secret that since the 2019 Avengers Endgame, the company was asked to scale up in an unprecedented way to feed its fledgling streaming service. More content, feed us more. Feed me, Seymour! So you've got all of this. Iger said on a February 7th earnings call, some of our studios lost a little focus, so the first step that we're taking is that we've reduced volume. We've reduced output, particularly at Marvel, in order to ensure the films you're making can be even better. So, and this goes through all this. It seems like somebody... And I don't know if it's Iger, but somebody is feeling pressure to make Marvel a boy brand again. I don't know. It just seems like this is a thing that's coming. What do you think, Ms. Boss? Are we redoing
the MCU?
The MCU is the MCU done?
It's funny because I was reading an article about how the conversations that Christopher Nolan had with Robert Downey Jr.
Mm-hmm.
Because he has been playing Tony Stark for 12 years.
Something like that, yeah.
And everybody associates him with that, not the actor that we got to see in, like, Chaplin or... You know, if you want to look at Tropic Thunder or, you know, all these other non-superhero type films, you know, showing that he actually has acting chops.
Yeah.
And, you know, unfortunately, superheroes, yeah, you get to do this and a snap, but it doesn't exactly show your acting chops, in my opinion. And Robert Downey Jr. is good as an actor. And so Nolan had this conversation of, okay, you're past this. Let's show people what you can do. Get out of what you've been doing. I mean, it was one of those type of conversations which got him into Oppenheimer. And look at him, you know, with the awards season. It's paying off because the guy you see there on the film is not Tony Stark. Which is good because it's going to start showing
his range. Yeah,
the quality per actor he is.
Yeah.
So, you know, when, you know, I feel bad for everybody who's been part of the MCU for all this time because it has typecast them maybe a little bit. And, you know, okay, you did your thing. And there's a time where, you know, relationships have to end sometimes. It was good while it was going. Don't overdo it.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, they decided to oversaturate with all the shows that just didn't need to be done. Think how much money Disney would have saved.
Yeah.
To pay off all the debts that they have coming up.
Well, think of all the money that they could have made if they kept the Marvel Universe male-centric. I mean, we had that story earlier about Silk, the TV show that they're working on in the Spider-Man universe. Now, granted, it's over at Sony, but they have since basically fired everybody and said, we're starting all over again, and this time let's make the show for guys.
Silk?
Silk is a Spider-Man character.
Oh, okay. They're going to attempt more Spider-Man stuff.
Well, she's a female. She's a female who was bitten by the same radioactive spider that Peter Parker was bitten by.
So basically, it's
Petra
Parker.
Well, she's a I don't know how popular the character is, But you have this huge universe of characters in the Spider-Man universe. But Spider-Man and his related characters have always kind of skewed toward a male, like comic books skew toward a male audience. And if somebody, and who knows who it is, if somebody is sitting there saying, hey, you know what? Even you look at Madam Web, the audience for that, what, 62% of them were male? Even though it was marketed toward a female audience, you know, girl power and woman magic and whatever, men went to go see it, probably for Sydney Sweeney.
Okay. You know, they sat there and spandex, they did it to that one ghosting movie with some girls in it, like forever ago, that we don't talk about, like Highlander 2. And you get actresses like that for girl-centric, and I'm talking about the blonde annoying one that is all over the place. I don't remember her name. I don't want to. But
the blonde annoying one. You mean Brie Larson?
I'm talking about Ghostbusters, the woman one.
Ghostbusters. Oh.
What's her name?
The blonde.
She's not funny.
Oh, the one from Saturday Night Live.
The blonde one who's all over the place and she's not funny and people have been picking on her for the puffy face lately.
She wasn't in Ghostbusters. She wasn't in Ghostbusters. I know who you're talking about. Amy. Oh, help me out, chat. She was going to not Kate McKinnon. You're not thinking about I'm thinking Kate McKinnon. She was Amy Schumer is who you're thinking about. Thank you, snob. Amy Schumer. Because Amy Schumer was supposed to do Amy Schumer was going to do She-Hulk, I thought, at one. No, Amy Schumer was going to do Barbie. And she's the one who's kind of
Melissa
gotten,
McCarthy.
Oh, you're talking about Melissa McCarthy. Okay. Well, Amy Schumer, Melissa McCarthy, I mean, they're almost interchangeable at this point.
Pretty much they are.
Yeah.
I mean, and it's just, they're not funny. But that's supposed to be girl power?
Well, no. Girls aren't funny.
Oh, we're going to have words. We're going to have words.
Anyway, speaking of words and girl power... This frame grab, Tom Connors over at Midnight's Edge shared this. This is Matt Bologna over at Puck. And light feedback this holiday week, Mr. Bologna writes, but I want to share a DM I got from a Disney executive in response to Thursday's column on whether the politicization of the Disney brand impacts box office. Spoilers, it does. Everyone says it's the movie stupid, which is an easy thing for people to say. More appealing movies are a great way to jump the political issues. But more and more, our audience, or the segment of the audience that has been politicized, equate the perceived messaging in a film as a quality issue. They won't say they find female empowerment distasteful in the Marvels or Star Wars, the latest trilogy starring Daisy Ridley, but they will say they don't like those movies because they're bad. So make better movies becomes code for make movies that conform to regressive gender stereotypes or put men in front and center in the narrative, which is what you're seeing now and what Bob's Pivot is about right now. Okay. This is the same lack of self-awareness that the Hugos are dealing with right now. This is the same lack of self-awareness for people who sit there and go, are we the bad guys? Yes, you are. Yes, you are. And this denial is unbelievably out of touch. But this is how it is. And again, this goes back to conversations that we've had before. We've had them on other channels. We've had them here. These people who are in charge right now see everything through the lens of personal politics. So if you don't like something and you talk about the writing is bad, the acting is bad, the story is crap, don't like the music, the sound mix is weird, all of those different things, they take it as a personal affront that you are attacking them and not the work. And it absolutely makes total sense that this Disney executive, unnamed Disney executive, would sit there and go, well, you know, they criticize the craft, but what they really mean... No. Because the people who are criticizing this stuff, and I've done it, and several others, you know, people from, you know, Nerdrotic and that Star Wars girl and Midnight's Edge and Cameron and everybody, we will make a delineation between the craft elements, the writing, the acting, the editing, the sound, the music, the casting. We will make distinctions between that and between
the message.
If you're going to give us a message movie, we'll call it out. If you're going to give us a movie that tries to tell a story but gets the writing wrong, gets the source material wrong, anything like that, from a standpoint of the actual work done to make the thing, we criticize that separately from
the message.
It's funny. So today I was at physical therapy, right? And I was talking to my therapist that I'm working with. And he was asking us if we enjoyed Argyle.
Yeah.
And his wife went and saw it. And so we were talking about that. We started talking about Henry Cavill.
Cavill.
'Cause I always say it wrong. And started going down the stuff. What's the other project he's working on right now?
I mean, Warhammer 40K.
Warhammer, thank you.
Yes.
Because I couldn't remember it for the life of me. But we were sitting there and we were discussing some of the, you know, we talk about people who are in the writer's room who have no clue. And so we were talking about Witcher. We were talking about The Acolyte, you know, that one show, you know, someone who's never seen. I was telling him about what you had read about Sydney Sweeney doing her homework. And, well, my character comes in like this and this and that, and
yeah,
they're just like pat on the head. And we were talking, he's actually okay with him doing Highlander. Cautiously, but he's okay with this.
No, wait. Not stop. It was physical therapy, not just therapy. Our marriage is fine. Physical therapy. And no, I am not the cause of her need for physical therapy before anybody asks.
But so we were going through and talking, but he was talking about Madam Web. And how he heard that it was just awful. And I was telling him how people are saying that Waterworld is better than that. And his face just blew up. He was laughing hard. I'm like, yeah, we're going to get along.
Yeah, right.
But he also sat there and pointed out, you know, he was talking about DC. He was talking about... what they've, you know, with Justice League and stuff like that. But I pointed out, I'm like, was it Justice League or was it Snyder, you know, screwing it up? I'm like, you know, it's a slow thing. And he was laughing. But he did sit there and think that Henry Cavill was underused and got the shaft as Superman.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, see, Henry Cavill never got to play Superman.
Yeah.
He kind of did in Joss Whedon's version of Justice League. But Mazers is saying it's Cavill. I've heard him say Cavill. So I'll research it to make sure, but I'm pretty sure it's Cavill. Oh, Mazers is kidding. Oh, Cavell. Hey, Cavell, like
Cavell. Ah, you funny. You funny.
Yeah, funny.
That bad dad joke means you owe us Mexican food.
Is that going to put you in therapy?
That's going to put me in therapy.
By the way,
if I saw Mr. Boss's teeth,
yeah, speaking
in a
of,
smile, that would put me in therapy.
Speaking of, yeah, I was just about to say, Keely, because Anna just got back from her honeymoon in Rio de Janeiro. So congratulations to her and Mr. Peaches. And I really feel bad for her getting the cake, the bakers getting the cake wrong. That
they got the cake wrong. What
oh
happened?
Yeah, it was. She did a whole thing on it, and her stream coming back was like 4 hours long. I skipped through it, but she posted over on her socials. She had this photograph of the cake that she ordered, and it's a gorgeous cake. It's wonderful, nice and decorated, and what she got instead of a white frosting cake was kind of sort of a schmear yellow cake with Disney character appliques on it. She's like, this is not what I ordered. They're not making it good. I feel bad for her. So
did she at least get a chance to eat it?
Well, I guess. I don't know. But
you know, my complaint, not to ours. We were smart. We did cupcakes. You go pick up the cupcake that you want.
Yes. We were smart about our wedding on a lot of things. Yes, no, but she's gotten responses from other people complaining about that same bakery. Did she have cupcakes too, Cam? All right. So, yeah, that's the thing. But see, here's the thing, to get back on track. If Marvel is pivoting back to let's make this a boy brand again, it has to be coming from somebody other. Well, I say it has to. It might be from somebody other than Feige. If Kevin Feige has realized Phase 4 and Phase 5 was a mistake, either there's been a come-to-Jesus meeting somewhere up top, in which case, maybe there's also been a come-to-Jesus meeting over at Lucasfilm. And maybe Lucasfilm has been told, let's make Star Wars a boy brand again. I'm not saying that's happened. I don't know. It would be nice. Snob says, why do girls want to take guy stuff and make it girl stuff? We don't do that to their stuff. Well, you know, it's that third wave feminism that infected everything. But in the meantime, while Disney is trying to figure that out, while Marvel's trying to figure themselves out, we have yet another lawsuit dropped against Disney. And it's not just Disney that's got hit with this one. Fubo TV files a $1 billion lawsuit seeking to block Disney, Warner's, and Fox Sports streaming platform. This is the one that was announced the day before the earnings call. It was announced after we heard about Gina's lawsuit. They put this news out there that, hey, oh, we're going to fix things. This is This is an antitrust lawsuit, and Fubo TV is coming out, and they've put a statement out on Twitter that says, today Fubo is fighting back. We have filed a lawsuit against Walt Disney, Fox, Warner Brothers Discovery, and their affiliates for their anti-competitive tactics. Even before their joint venture was announced, we believe these companies have had a clear agenda to eliminate competition by forcing distributors like Fubo to carry hundreds of unwanted channels, which force higher prices and stifle our innovation, while giving themselves the ability to market and sell live sport-only services without the same restrictions. So, this is Hollywood Reporter, the media giants teaming up on a new platform that will pool together sports streaming rights, are facing an antitrust lawsuit from rival sports streamer Fubo, which alleges that it's being forced to carry dozens of pricey non-sports channels as a condition of licensing sports rights from the companies in a scheme to stifle competition. The lawsuit filed in New York federal court on Tuesday under seal names the Walt Disney Company, Fox Corporation, and Warner Brothers Discovery and seeks to block the joint venture. The untitled streaming platform, announced February 6 and scheduled to launch this fall, will offer live linear channels like ESPN, Fox, ABC, TNT, TBS, as well as games and other sports rights from all three companies on a non-exclusive basis. This was their mad scramble. We've got to do something to make money on streaming. And it's all sports. Because they know they can't entertain anybody because nobody's watching anything. And the stuff that they are watching, as we talked about yesterday, according to Nielsen, all of the stuff that they are watching is 5 years old or older. Friends, Gilmore Girls, Suits. They're not watching any of the new stuff because the new stuff is crap.
Quality stuff.
That's right. The suit accuses the media giants of leveraging their iron grip on sports content to extract billions of dollars in supra-competitive profits, leading to consumers pay more for highly popular sports content. Now, this is nothing new. This is something that they've done back in the days of cable. Because you pay for basic cable, you pay a fee, you get 40-some-odd channels. But if you want the Sci-Fi Channel, for example, when we first got cable, the Sci-Fi Channel was part of a additional add-on tier. You pay like $10 a month extra, and you get these other 15 channels. And if you want premium stuff like HBO or Showtime or Cinemax or I don't know, I guess those were the big ones, then you have to pay even more. And if you want any of the racy stuff, you pay even more. Because they were offered all separately in these different packages. And sometimes they'd bundle, you know, HBO and Showtime together, or HBO and Cinemax together, Showtime and Cinemax together, or whatever. So with licensing, if I'm going to come in and I'm a network, if I own a series of networks, let's say I'm Disney, I own ABC, I own ESPN, I own Disney Channel.
Does that mean I get a board of directors?
No, not yet. So if that happens, then Disney comes in and says, okay, if you want ABC and ESPN, you have to take Disney Plus. So that's that kind of thing is what's going on here. So FuboTV has launched this lawsuit in order to stop this big conglomerate thing from happening. So we'll see how that goes, because that's going to be real interesting to see how that goes. Disney is not having a good year.
Woke, you go broke.
Well, I think it's more than that. I think it's more than just that. But anyway, all right, here's what we're going to do. We're going to take a break. When we get back, very excited about this. And Professor Harry Turtledove is going to join us. And we're going to talk about his new book. So stand by. We will be right back.
You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
And it's a real pleasure for me as a longtime fan to be sitting here with Aaron Gray.
Here with Larry Hama.
We're talking with Kevin J. Anderson, best-selling author.
Mr. Neil Adams.
I am here with David Britt.
Axel Alonso, editor.
Shadow Stevens.
And Devil's Comic-Con with John DeLancey.
With Tom King.
Kevin Conroy.
Free comic book day.
Denise Crosby.
PopCon. Pop Expo.
Here on location at Star Wars Celebration.
Sci-Fi Expo, talking for our second time with Gil Gerard.
Wichita, Kansas at Time Eddie.
Producer David Gerald.
Yeah, I've got Eric Flint.
We are here at Smallville Comic Con.
Wizard World St. Louis.
Village Con in Bentonville, Arkansas.
Speaking with Michael Lombardi.
We are talking with Alan Dean.
Quincy Allen.
Suzanne Landon.
Of Starlog Magazine. Mr. Kerry Oakwood.
Chris Sami.
Lynn Lee.
Dave Schwartz.
Mano Interami.
John.
Jason Aaron.
This is Sci-Fi for Me. your portal to the science fiction multiverse. Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Be sure to connect with us on social media and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss our next broadcast. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, here we go. We are back live from the bunker, and we are here in the second hour, which is reserved for our special guests. And today, we have with us a special guest, Harry Turtledove. He is the author of a number of different alternate history books. He has a Ph.D. in the Byzantine Empire, I think is what I read.
That's what it is. And, you want fries with that?
Right. So he joins us today. He's got a new book that just came out in December called The Wages of Sin. It is a 19th century England ravaged by HIV. And it's got me thinking, what kind of what if do you have to ask in order to get to that kind of story, Professor?
Well, I think what I was asking myself was, and please just call me Harry. It's who I am, for God's sake. I was thinking, what if HIV got loose when there was nothing that anybody could do about it? And what sort of social changes would that require to keep the disease from killing basically just about everybody? And all of the changes I thought of that might possibly be created were sexist and otherwise unpleasant and probably would have happened anyway. And that's what I wrote the book about.
So what kind of research do you have to do for that kind of story? Because we've talked to other people, other authors who are dealing with historical fiction, and it's always generally easier to tell a story that's like 300 years in the future or 400 years in the future, because you can just make up anything. Whereas if you're telling a story that's 10 years in the future or 15 years, it's kind of hard to get that. How far are we going to advance? But if you're going backwards into historic territory, then there are going to be those people out there who say, well, actually, and they start nitpicking at all the things.
Well, in this one, I have an advantage because the place where almost all of the story is set is 350 years later than the change. So a whole bunch of stuff will have changed, and I'm allowed to goof with it a little more than I would be if I were doing it immediately afterwards, where most of the stuff and most of the people are still the same.
Yeah.
So that was an advantage. I mean, I know something about HIV. I went to grad school with a fellow who got his PhD a couple of years ahead of me and died in 1986 at the age of 41. Mm. Poor guy. He was one of the people who was unlucky enough to catch it before there was anything much anybody could do about it, and it killed
right.
him.
Right.
And so I thought, what if everybody was like that? What if you catch it, you are going to die and die slowly and unpleasantly? And how do we stop that from happening as much as we can?
So give me a Reader's Digest pre-see, if you will, about The Wages of Sin, the story as a whole, without getting into spoilers, because we want people to read the book. We don't want to give it away.
It's a world where women are secluded, where they live in their own quarters. It's a world where no matter how bright you are, if you're female, it ain't going to do you any good unless you can find a man to steer. It's a world where if you go out in public, you cover up and you get yelled at anyway. And what is it like if you are a bright young woman who is stuck in this, and how crazy does it make you, and what do you do about it? And what happens if you have a fiance who is studying for law in London, the big wicked city, and does something very stupid? What do you do after that? What kind of chances are you willing to take? Why are you willing to take them if you're willing to take them? Those are the kinds of things that I'm dealing with.
Well, and it's funny that, you know, you get there with this, you know, historical side of things, but the fact that you're in, you know, the big city of London where things go horribly stupid, I'm like, is that historical or is that modern era? Because it doesn't seem like things have changed.
Oh no, there is all sorts of, you know, erotica in the real 19th century set in London where you could get anything, anybody. All you had to do was lay out enough coin.
Yeah. But it's funny, your pinned tweet from August of 2022 over on Twitter. I didn't mean to be topical. I mean, it's funny, but it's painfully true because, I mean, the last few years have almost read like a weird post-apocalyptic dystopian type of thing.
This idea and wrote the first few chapters of it well before the COVID pandemic broke out and then set it aside for a while because, you know, I had to figure out what exactly am I going to do with it, and then came back to it and eventually sold it and got it into print. But I mean, the idea predates the pandemic, this pandemic, because of course I'm old enough. I mean, look at me, for God's sake, I'm old enough to remember the AIDS pandemic in the 80s.
Yeah. So what was the idea behind putting it in 19th century England as opposed to some other place in the historical timeline?
Well, I wanted people who would be at least moderately recognizable. I wanted, I've been to London. I've been to Salisbury. I know the places that I'm writing about, which is always an advantage.
Sure.
And I wanted, you know, relatable people. And that's what I hope I got.
Now, when you get into historical locations and you get, I'm assuming that people that are actual real people in those settings, how much liberty are you taking with those historic figures as characters?
Well, in this particular book, I don't believe that anyone who actually appears on stage is a real historical character.
Okay.
I have people like Henry VIII, you know, 300 years earlier, dying of HIV instead of, you know, living. And that, you know, that changes things quite a bit. That is a general issue with alternate history, though, you know, and it's one of the interesting things about it. How would this person react if faced with conditions altogether different from the ones that he or she met in real life? That, you know, that's the fun of the game, is imagining something like that.
See, I was talking to Dan Dickholtz about his book, Wavelengths. He was a contributing writer over at Starlog Magazine. And his book is a collection of what-if stories as if they came from a Starlog type magazine and other universe.
That's a very nice conceit. I like that.
And one of the things in there was, what if George Lucas had failed with Star Wars, and how does his career trajectory go? What if Gene Roddenberry has succeeded with one of his other TV series in the 70s? And it's interesting, the conversation, because you start with a premise. You start with a what-if premise. And like you say, with Henry VIII dying from this disease instead of living, okay, what happens next? And then what happens next? And the consequences. And then you have this little butterfly effect. How much of that are you plotting out ahead of time, saying, okay, well, if this happens, then this over here can't happen now, so this other thing has to happen. Does your flow chart look pretty complicated by the time you get done?
I am one of those disgusting people who I write by the seat of my pants, and very often I am telling myself the story as I am writing it. I have very little idea of what's going to happen next until it does. Sometimes I know where I'm going, but I hardly ever know how I'm going to get there. It makes things interesting every now and again.
I can imagine. Well, because the description of this book in Amazon says it's meticulously researched, as only Harry Turtledove can do. And I'm assuming that you've probably got all sorts of notes everywhere. You've got this, all of this information in your head. Is that just ready recall that you have, that you're able to just, you know,
I have that. Yes. Yeah. I carry preposterous amounts of stuff in my head, and it does weird things when it's in there. I mean, this is probably what makes me a writer to begin with. You know, I'm at the neurotypical end of the autism spectrum, but I'm probably on it. You know, almost certainly on it. So it's just, you know, it is what I am, and I do the best I can with it. I'm probably unfit for honest work, so I'm a writer instead.
So how did you get started with the alternate history stuff? Because your first couple of books were not in this category, and you've kind of become known as the writer of alternate history. Anybody says Harry Turtledove's name, it's alternate history stuff. They don't talk about a lot of the rest of the books
I know,
that you've written,
which bothers me sometimes, because I like to think the other stuff is halfway decent too. But how did this happen? I've read and loved science fiction since I was a little kid. I was going to be a scientist when I grew up. I thought I was. I hoped I was. I was one of the smart kids in high school. When I graduated from high school, I got into Caltech. And I flunked out at the end of my freshman year because calculus was much tougher than I was. I spent the next year at Cal State LA getting my GPA up to the point where it was visible, A, to my naked eye, and B, to my draft board's naked eye, which was a relevant consideration considering that this was 1967-68.
Okay, yeah, right in the middle of Vietnam.
Oh, yes. Yeah. And then I spent the last 2 years of my undergrad career and my time in grad school at UCLA, and I ended up with a PhD in Byzantine history because I'm a science fiction person. When I was maybe 14 or 15, I picked up L. Sprague de Camp's book, Lest Darkness Fall, which drops a modern man into Ostrogothic Italy. It's a, you know, it's a Connecticut Yankee story.
Sure. Yep.
And I got hooked trying to find out how much Sprague was making up and how much was real. And the answer was he wasn't making up a whole lot, and most of it was real. Hmm. And I got hooked, and I got hooked. And that is why I have a PhD in Byzantine history today. I mean, writers are dangerous people. They can screw up your life without even ever meeting you. You know, I mean, if I hadn't found that book in that secondhand bookstore, then let's see, I wouldn't have the degree I have. I wouldn't have written most of what I've written. I probably would have written something. I was already trying to be a writer by then. I wouldn't be married to the lady that I'm married to, because I met her when I was teaching at UCLA, when the professor under whom I studied had a guest gig in Greece. I wouldn't have the kids I have. Other than that, it didn't change my life at all, you know?
Right. Well, yeah. See, and it's just that it's weird, because every now and again I'll see discussion, you know, if you could go back to when you were 18, if you could go back to your college years, what would you say to yourself? And I'm sitting here thinking to myself, I would avoid all contact with myself from back then, because in anything that changes, everything changes.
Yep.
And you get to play in that sandbox with the stories that you write, because you get to do this, and then, you know, you can tuck it away and go home at the end of the day, and real life hasn't changed. You haven't destroyed the timeline or anything. You get to do that in these books that you write, and have all sorts of mayhem and chaos happen over there. What's the appeal for you that keeps you coming back to this kind of story?
Well, as I say, I always wanted to write science fiction, and I'm trained as a historian. And alternate history, you know, look, most science fiction changes something in the present or in the near future, and then looks at what happens, you know, farther up in the timeline. Alternate history does exactly the same thing, except it does it in the past, where you change something in the more distant past and then look at the more recent past or the present, incorporating that change. I mean, it is, you know, it is the standard SF extrapolation. It's just put in a different place in the timeline.
Yeah.
And so if you're somebody who's always loved science fiction and always wanted to write science fiction, and you're somebody who's trained as a historian and knows how to do that particular kind of research, what are you going to do?
Right.
I did it.
Well, and I'm looking at your bibliography, and there's a lot here that, you know, people probably, like we're talking about, people may not be familiar with. Out of all of the stuff that you've written outside of the historical fiction, what other stuff do you want people to actually pay attention to and sit there and go, read this, in addition to the historical stuff, the alternate history stuff? We need to be aware of what other, I mean, sure, all of them, but do you have particular favorites? Sure.
I mean, everyone who's watching this or listening to this should immediately run right out, go to Amazon or go to your bookstore, purchase my entire catalog. You know,
right.
I mean, you know, obviously.
Sure. Well, and that brings up an interesting point, because I have made it a point in especially post-pandemic. And in the wake of what was going on with the Roald Dahl situation, with, you know, the recontextualizing, you know, classic literature, and you've got, you know, we're going to re-edit for the modern audience and modern sensibilities. Now, wait a minute, that changes the literature, and
yeah.
So now I'm, you know, we make a point of going to the used bookstores and getting the stuff that was printed before it can be digitally whitewashed, censored, 1984, whatever you want to call it. And it's...
They've been doing that with, you know, with the Hardy Boys and the Nancy Drews for a long time, too.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, this stuff, you know, this, they do that. I think it's unfortunate, but they do, you know.
But it behooves us, I mean, especially if the stuff is out of print currently, you know, to go back to these bookstores and say, okay, I need to get all of the back catalog for this author and that author. So, you know, if people are going to go get the Harry Turtledove collection, is everything still in print, or is there stuff they're going to have to dig for
most
in the corner?
Most of the stuff is still in print, yeah.
Okay. Do you have a favorite out of everything that you've written?
I wouldn't call it a favorite exactly, because that's like asking me what my favorite kid is, you know.
Sure. Yeah.
And that's, you know, I mean, these are children of my imagination. But I think the book that I had the most fun writing is a very silly fantasy called Every Inch a King, which is set in a fantasy analog of the Balkans just before the First World War.
Hmm.
There was, in the real world, a German circus performer who claimed that in the aftermath of the Balkan Wars, that for 5 days he was king of Albania. The Albanians wanted a Muslim prince from the Ottoman Empire because Albania was a mostly Muslim country, and they had sort of reluctantly gained their independence from the Ottomans. And this guy got word of this, and A, he was a ringer for the prince, and B, he spoke fluent Turkish because he'd done two hitches in the Ottoman army. And he went, or said he went, to Albania, was crowned king of Albania, was king of Albania for 5 days, disported himself in the harem that they recruited for him, for the hell of it, declared war on Montenegro. And when his story started to unravel, he and his sidekick got out of there with the royal treasury in their back pocket. Of course, it probably amounted to $5.19, but even so. And he dined out on this story for the rest of his life. 20 years later, he wrote an autobiography that he called Fünf Tage König von Albanien, King of Albania for 5 days. And 45 years after this happened, when Prince Rainier of Monaco married Grace Kelly, he tried to get an invitation to the wedding on the grounds that he was a former crowned head of Europe. Didn't work, but I mean, this guy had balls, you know, the size of bowling balls, and they were made of solid brass. I'll transpose this into a fantasy world, and it's, you know, it's as silly as I could make it, and it parts of it are really based on his autobiography, which I read in German, God help me.
Now, on the flip side of that, when you're putting together these stories, you're working on the what ifs. Have you ever gotten to a point where you're starting on a story and it just doesn't work and you've got to kill it? How often does that happen?
That's happened a few times. It doesn't happen very often, but it's happened a few times.
Yeah. Do you ever recycle any of these ideas to
put
into something else?
Of course you do. You know, you never throw anything away. You know, you always, you know, take bits and pieces from stuff that didn't work and put it together in ways that work better.
Yeah.
That's part of the gig.
Is it easy for you at this point in your career? Is it easier to kill your darlings, or is it a challenge just as much as it always has been, or has it ever been? I mean, there are some authors I've talked to that's like, nope, it doesn't work, throw it out.
Yeah, that's what you've got to do. Sometimes it just doesn't.
Is there anything that you haven't written yet that's still percolating back there? Is that there was that one idea that you just haven't cracked yet?
Oh, that kind of stuff happens all the time. Sometimes years and years will go by before, you know, you have the idea. But you know, one of the things that people who aren't writers don't always see right away is that there's a difference, and it's an enormous difference, between having an idea and having a story.
Right.
And, you know, getting across the gulf between the one and the other is often the hard part.
Yeah. I guess for some writers, it would be more difficult to do that without an outline. I mean, the pantser process has always mystified me. I can't do it. I'll always paint myself into a corner. It's like, okay, where do I go from here? And it just seems like alchemy. I mean, almost, because
everybody does it differently. There, you know, one of the hard parts about this thing is that nobody can tell you how to do it. The only thing anybody can tell you is this is what works for me.
Yeah.
And, you know, this is what works for me. I mean, I'm, you know, I'm weird all kinds of ways. I do first drafts in longhand, for heaven's sake.
Did you study when you first started out and you decided you were going to be a writer? Did you study particular processes? You know, were they here's how to be a writer type of books or instruction material?
No, I just started trying to write and seeing what happened. I mean, that's how I came to do drafts in longhand, because I started when I was in my teens. I started composing at a typewriter. And I don't know if you're old enough to remember or not, but typewriters are not user-friendly instruments.
No, they're not.
You know, I would get halfway down a page and then have trouble saying what I wanted to say, and I would say it one way, and I would go, no, that's crap, and I would take it out of the typewriter and retype and then try it, another way. And I would go, no, that's crap. And I got tired of retyping it. So when I came to a spot where I was having trouble, I would do it in longhand till I had it the way I wanted and then transcribe it.
Yeah.
And after a while, I thought, you know, this is trying to tell me something. And I put the typewriter aside and I just, you know, and I did my first draft in longhand and, you know, got it as good as I could get it. And then when I typed it up, I cleaned up as much of the goo and crap that was still in there after I had done it in longhand. And then I'd send it off and see what happened. I am one of the people who are lucky enough. I'm able to write fairly clean first draft copy. If I couldn't, I would have to do it some other way. But I'm lucky enough to do that.
Do you self-edit a lot as you're writing, or do you just write the whole thing up to a certain point and then you go back and review it and change it after that? Or are you doing it on the fly as you go?
I'm usually doing it on the fly as I go. Sometimes I will see later that I need to put stuff in earlier, and I'll go back in the computer version of as much as I've gotten onto my hard drive and do the changes there. Yeah.
What about beta readers? You say
my wife is also a writer, and we are the first readers and editors of each other's stuff.
Does that ever go awkward?
No, it really doesn't, because we get along very well. I know how lucky I am, because I had a marriage before this that didn't work, and I'm lucky. We get along.
Now, do you let your kids see any of the stuff before it's published, or just your wife, and then it goes to the editor?
They aren't interested most of the time.
Kids these days, right?
They're grown people with their own lives now, so yeah.
What does that do though when you're a relatively well-known, popular, famous, I mean whatever adjective you want to put in there, successful?
I am not famous, trust me.
In our circles you are.
Small circles.
People know the name Harry Turtledove. Like I said, it's generally associated with historical science fiction, alternate universe stuff, alternate history stuff. So whenever I run across somebody who here, I'm in media, I make TV commercials. Oh, that's so cool! You get the people who are outside of the business think that this is much more glamorous than it actually is, but
which is true of most things.
It is. But does your family kind of keep you grounded? And do you know who I am? I'm a Harry Turtledove. I mean, do they bring you down?
Do that. Because I know perfectly well that if I'm not in SF circles, nobody has the slightest idea who I am or care.
Do you do conventions? Do you go to things like?
I have not done them since COVID, being old and not too skinny. And, I mean, I'm just, you know, I just don't.
Yeah. So have you kept an eye on what's been going on with the Hugos this year?
A very distant eye. I am not really fit to comment on that. I think, yeah. You know, if it's anywhere near what it looks like, I think it's highly unfortunate what happened. And I think that's obvious enough that I don't hardly need to say it.
Yeah. Yeah. It's such a bizarre situation over there. Just, I watch it. And I'm like, this is a train wreck happening and you can't keep yourself from looking at it. It's, hopefully we're at the tail end of all of the information coming out, because if it just continues to get worse, I don't think that's going to be good for anybody.
No, you know, the unfortunate thing is, or one of the many unfortunate things is, that this is going to cast a long shadow down Worldcon and down Hugo nominations and Hugo elections generally.
Yeah, yeah, it is. It's unfortunate.
Now, it really is.
How does it feel when you win an award? I mean, because you've won several.
I've won a Hugo. I've won some Sidewises. I won one at Dragon Con. It always amazes me. You know, I mean, it's, you know, it's nice to find out that other people like what you do. I was, you know, when I won the Hugo. It was the 94 Worldcon at Winnipeg. Mm-hmm. And of course it was late evening and my kids were little then, you know, they were in childcare, and I walked over there and I was carrying the Hugo, you know, and I told them, hey, don't get upset if I lose, because I did not expect to win. And, you know, it's just, you know, it's an honor to be nominated, and it is, it always is. And I walked in there with squealed, you won. And they were as gobsmacked as I was.
Has the Hugo lost any of its prestige, do you think, in the last, say, 8, 10 years, 15 years, because of all of the debate back and forth over stuff?
Stuff.
I mean, that's kind of I'm deliberately vague, because, you know, just.
Yeah, I know. There's been a lot of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, the arguments on either side of things, and, you know, this is not allowed, and this is bad, and that's good, and this, you know, the groups and the tribalism and all of the neener back and forth. A lot of people these days say, well, it won a Hugo Award in the last 10 years. That tells me I don't want to read it, and that's kind of a sad state of affairs. How does the Hugo? I mean, this latest scandal, just, you know, notwithstanding, how does the Hugo get its prestige back, do you think?
I have no good answer for that. I don't think anyone has a good answer for that. I wish I did, but I ain't that smart.
No. So what is next for you? What are you working on now?
Well, let's see. What am I working on now? I have sold a novel that will be out in early 2025 called Twice as Dead, which is a noirish urban fantasy set in post-war Los Angeles with police corruption and vampires and all that good stuff. And I have just literally just, I'm only a couple of days into it, started on a sequel to that, which has no title and which I'm sort of figuring out as I go.
Well, your first book, your first stories were kind of in that horror space. Is that something you have done? I mean,
well, it's not horror. It's, you know, it's urban fantasy is what I'd call it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, with vampires, you automatically think of the universal monsters and that sort of thing. Your first two books, Where Blood and Where Night, just looking at that, that sounds like horror monster type of things. Is there a space?
Well, it is and it isn't. I mean, what, you know, the Where Night, this is set, it's a fantasy world. It has four moons.
Hmm.
Once every several hundred years, I forget exactly how many, all of them are full at the same time. And everything that has the slightest trace of were blood in it goes where.
Oh, my.
And, you know, it's sort of like Asimov's story Nightfall, in that, you know, all right, this is something that sends the entire world crazy for a day.
Yeah.
So that was the MacGuffin there.
Do you have a particular time period that you like to stay in with your alternate history? Because you've kind of been all over.
I've been not all over. I've been a lot of places. There are places where I probably won't ever work because I'll never know enough to do it convincingly.
Right.
I doubt that you will ever. It's funny. I was talking with my wife about this just yesterday or the day before. I probably won't ever write in the period of the Napoleonic Wars because I don't know enough about it. And I know that it's like the American Civil War. There are lots of people who know a lot more about it than I do. And if I screw up, no, excuse me, when I screw up, they will inform me in loud, screechy voices.
Well, you know, in those particular cases, when you're doing your research, do you consult with other people, academics and researchers and historians?
I have been known to. Sometimes you have to because you can't find things out any other way.
Yeah.
Back in the day, I was working on a science fiction story. I write regular SF, too. And it was set on Jupiter's moon Io. And I needed to know where in the sky at a particular point of Io, where Jupiter would be. And to do that, I needed to know how the 0-0 point of latitude and longitude was defined. And I got on the phone, and this was before I could conveniently email. This was late 80s or early 90s.
Yeah.
I called JPL and I asked them. And the guy I got hold of said, "Isn't that an interesting question? Let me get back to you." And he called me back the day after with the answer. I mean, he probably had to go and ask somebody. In case you're curious, the 0-0 point on Io is the point where the line between Io's center of mass and Jupiter's center of mass comes out through the surface of the moon. Now you know.
Well, and I imagine the internet has made it. On the one hand, has made it easier to do that research, but on the other hand, nowadays, I was talking to David Levine about this yesterday. The fact that you've got AI creating all sorts of interesting answers to questions that may or may not be factual, mm-hmm. And now how do you vet the information that you get in your research? It's almost like we're having to get back to the used bookstore and get the Encyclopedia Britannica from 20 years ago.
I've got print encyclopedias that date, through most of the 20th century, and I use them sometimes. The internet is, even now, and it was much more true 15 years ago, even now, the internet is great for quick and dirty when you want to get down in the, into the details, then you need to hit the literature.
Do you find that it's better or just different? Which do you prefer?
Well, it's, the advantage of pulling out an iPad and checking a fact very quickly is nice, where I don't have to go upstairs and paw through the books. If I can do it fast, I'll do it fast. If I have reasonable confidence that the information that I get is accurate.
Yeah. Has there ever been a time when you're doing your research and you run across something that's historical fact, but nobody would ever believe it?
Well, that kind of stuff does happen. For example, there was in later medieval France, there was a common expression of surprise and such that was sacre merde, which translates literally to holy shit.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, yeah, it's true, but you'd have trouble using it because people think, yeah, you're making that crap up.
Yeah. Hey, what about customs and rituals and, you know, those things where it's the little nitty-gritty details. How fine do you get in the granular stuff? Because, you know, a lot of times when people are talking about, especially when you're doing any kind of world building, the little details sometimes help sell the story, the realism of the story.
I've got a story for that. You may know that The Guns of the South, the one with Robert E. Lee holding a Kalashnikov on the cover, is probably my best known book, and it's the book that let me quit my day job. So I'm, you know, very pleased with it. And I was doing homework for this, and I knew that on February 22nd, 1864, Robert E. Lee took the train down from where he was stationed with the Army of Northern Virginia into Richmond to confer with Jefferson Davis, the president of the Confederacy. I knew where the train station was, and I knew where the Confederate White House was, and I knew some of the buildings that would be in between as Lee was traveling from the train station to meet with Davis.
Yeah.
And one of those buildings was the Confederate War Department. And when I first wrote this scene, it's February 1864. The Confederate states are busy losing the war. There will be couriers running in and out. There will be messengers galloping away with urgent orders. Got to do this, got to do that, got to save the CSA. A few days later, just by chance, I was poking in a library. I was poking through a book called Diary of a Rebel War Clerk by a fellow named John Beecham Jones, who was a clerk at the Confederate War Department. And not quite randomly, just on the off chance, I flipped to his entry for February 22nd, 1864, and he said, "War Department closed for Washington's birthday." And I rewrote that scene. Because if I hadn't rewritten that scene,
right,
somebody would have nailed me on it. You know, you can really get into the muck with this stuff.
Yeah. But you know, stuff like wardrobe and costume and technology, and you know, not to put too fine a point on it, but sometimes, you know, the bowler hat wasn't invented until such and such date or anything like that. How much do you stress about that stuff? I mean, the historical data is one thing, but the cultural stuff that was going on at the time, do you sweat the details a lot?
I try to. You know, one of the things that I have become resigned to is that being a writer, I'm going to make mistakes now and then, and they're going to get into print.
Mm-hmm.
And that does happen, and you know, okay, I was stupid. This happens. It happens to everybody.
Yeah.
You know, I first got to know Poul Anderson because I wrote, you know, 45 years ago, I wrote him one of those detail-filled letters. And he was much nicer about answering me than I am with most of my people.
Do you have that one fan that is just relentless?
I had a person like that. This person, all right, we go back to the Guns of the South again, and I had talked a little bit about the Confederacy doing reloads of, you know, spent brass with black powder charges, right?
Right.
And he actually made some and tried to shoot them and told me all about it. And I'm sorry. This is obsession above and beyond or below and beneath, really, the call of duty.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We've got somebody in the chat saying that they had an alternative far back history where humans did not win against Neanderthals, but a truce was called. And two hominid societies competed for the future dominance. That would be an interesting scene to
you know
out.
It's funny, I actually wrote a story like that. That's the story that I want a Hugo for. It's called Down in the Bottomlands. It imagines a world where, you know, the Mediterranean Sea dried out 5 million years ago and then refilled in a series of floods from the Atlantic. Mm-hmm. What if those floods didn't happen? What would the world look like? And I wrote a story about it, you know, imagining Neanderthals and Homo sapiens, you know, squaring off against one another. So, do it. I mean, you know, there are certainly more ways to do it than I did.
Yeah. Do you still do short stories? Or are you just
No, I do them. You know, some ideas are fun, but they aren't big enough to be novels.
Yeah. So somebody comes to you and says, "Hey, I'm putting together this anthology of X and so type of stories. What would it take to get Harry Turtledove as a contributor to an anthology? What incentives entice you to be part of a project?"
It's
like
sense of word and up. And it has to be the kind of anthology where I can either write what I want or where the proposed theme is something that I'm, you know, at least halfway interested in.
Yeah. How long does it take you to put something together in terms of like short stories and novels? Because, you know, with the research for the world building and stuff for the novels, I imagine that probably takes you longer than it would for a short story.
Yes.
How long does that take for you?
It varies wildly on the material. I mean, I started writing the books about an alien invasion in 1942. I started writing those in the early 90s, but I'd been doing homework for them since the 70s. One of the things that happened was that I got anticipated in one of the things that I wanted to do, because I wanted to have a brain trust of science fiction writers who would help people try and figure out what the aliens are up to, right?
Right.
And Jerry Purnell and Larry Niven beat me to it in their book Footfall. And I gave them grief about it too. Damn it, I had that idea.
I have said in the past that there's no such thing as an original idea anymore. It's just an original combination of elements. Because I ran across this myself when Star Trek: The Next Generation was on. The production had an open submission policy. You didn't have to have an agent. You could just write a script and you can send it, and they'd take two from anybody that didn't have an agent. And so I wrote this script, and I sat on it for a year, and then I pulled it out and said, let's revise it. And as soon as I sent it in, they ran an episode that did the exact same thing that I did. I was like, wait a minute. But, you know, it was far enough. It aired as I was sending it, so there's no way they could have seen mine. So I'm like, okay, somebody else had the same idea.
Yeah, that stuff happens.
And it happens. It's weird. It's almost like, especially with science fiction fans and science fiction writers, is you have the tropes, you have the stereotypes and the archetypes and that sort of thing, but it's how those elements are put together that gives you the originality of it. And it's when you have that, somebody else does it. I know it can be kind of frustrating, but I'm like, well, that happens all the time.
You know, in the late 80s, I published a book called A Different Flesh about Homo erectus reaching the New World and the Native Americans not. Mm-hmm. What would that be like when the Europeans found them? And Roger McBride Allen published Orphan of Creation about Australopithecines surviving in Africa. And Michael Bishop published Ancient Days about Homo habilis surviving. And all of these came within a few months of each other.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes ideas are just there.
It's like that time, that 1 year when we got two Christopher Columbus movies, and then there was another year when we got three different Long Island Lolita productions within like months of each other. Those were crazy times. So is there a type of story that you won't write?
I write very few real horror pieces. The only one that I've really done was a story called Crybaby, because I wrote it in the aftermath of the birth of one of our daughters who had colic and cried all the time.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
And I thought, what would it be, in lieu of punting the kid, I wrote a story about a demon baby that cried at the worst possible moments with the most malevolent effect.
Oh, that's that. As a father myself, I can appreciate that. So let me ask you, because the modern, we talked about, a lot of literature getting changed for modern sensibilities and whatnot. And there's been a lot of talk back and forth about the current culture, literature, movies, television. Something that I have observed, and this is pure opinion on my part. It's not based on facts as much as it's just observed things. It seems to me that the people who are in charge these days, the younger editors at the comic book publishers and the younger editors at the literary agencies, the people who are looking for stories have grown up with YouTube and TikTok and television and maybe have missed out on classic literature that could otherwise form a better appreciation for story. Have you run into this where, you've got people, because it brings to mind, somebody had said, because they were talking about hiring Walt Simonson, and somebody at DC was like, well, Walt Simonson's too old-fashioned. And I'm thinking, that's Walt Simonson. How do you dismiss somebody that great at comic book art? And I thought, this has got to be something that's more widespread. Have you run into that level of not quite informed enough to appreciate what the work is?
That happens now and again. I mean, but that kind of stuff has always happened as tastes change and as the things that you can say and can't say mm-hmm. change. I recently read Spike Milligan's autobiography, it was mostly the war years and the years right after that, and the casual racism and the casual anti-Semitism and the way he treated women would make anyone now, tear their hair. But yeah. It was just taken for granted. Things that you can do, things that you can say, though, they constantly change.
Right.
Most of the four-letter words that one could not say when I was a little kid, certainly could not put into print when I was a little kid, are in casual use. But there are other words that were in casual use then that one cannot say now.
Right.
Things change. Yeah. There are always going to be things you can't do, but what those things are will vary.
But do you ever run into somebody in the process of publishing your stories, and through the conversations you realize they just don't get it? Necessarily in terms of what you can and cannot do, but understanding the basics of story. And that kind of thing, where it's like, oh, okay, you need to read more.
Because I work mostly, I work in print, and the people who are drawn to this, to work in that field tend to be the better read people. So that is good.
Well, that's good. So this story that you've got coming out in 2025,
mm-hmm.
is there any other directions that you want to go with other stories that you're working on? Is that just the main focus?
You know, as I say, I've got a sequel to write, which I just started on day before yesterday. So I'm going to worry about that for the next few months, and after that, I'll see what I do next. I don't know. The other thing is, you don't know when you're going to get an idea or how good the idea is going to be or anything. You know, this is a weird racket. You know that. Come on.
I do. Let me ask you this, because something you mentioned earlier about emails and letters. Is there still value? Because post pandemic, a lot of, I saw this getting talked about some as well. Writing letters instead of sending email. Do you think there's still any value in that? Because there are a lot of writers that used to correspond with each other all the time, back and forth about stuff. And of course, you got all the different fanzines and the letters of comment that appears in the fanzines. Is that still, you think something is still of value there, that we should be doing more of that?
These days, letters, I think, are largely becoming a special effect. You know, when you want to put particular emphasis on something, you put it in a permanent form on paper and send it with a stamp and accept that it's going to take 3 days to get wherever it's going.
Yeah.
And there is a place for that, but I don't think that I certainly agree that it's not as universal as it used to be.
Have we
lost? I mean, and, you know, there are people I corresponded with for years, and then we got email, and we'd talk every now and then, and we'd meet on chat boards, and, you know. And
have we lost a certain aspect of our civilization because of the online sphere, the internet?
I don't think of it as a loss. I just, you know, it's a change. A lot of it is a gain, because I mean, you can get to know people online whom you would never have a chance to, meet in real life. On Twitter, I made friends with David Crosby, for God's sake. And because I found out that he had read some of my stuff, and of course I've been listening to him since I was in high school, for God's sake.
It's allowed us to connect here, and we do appreciate getting to know you.
In spite of that, it may be a good thing.
No, I think it is. There have been because when we first started talking about the fact that Harry Turtledove was going to be a guest, there were a lot of people who were excited about it. So I imagine that we'll get some.
I probably
some
cured that.
I don't think. I think we did fine. The book, The Wages of Sin, is out
I
now.
I can't show it to you. I came prepared.
Came prepared. There it is right there. The Wages of Sin. Harry Turtledove also is on Twitter. Let me pull that up here first.
At HN Turtledove.
There is that. And then the website. We've got links to these, so people can go check that out. That's in the video notes over there. So you can check those out.
I was younger on that picture, my God.
All right. Harry Turtledove, thank you very much for spending the time here talking to us today. When the next book comes out, we'll have to have you back. But sometime between now and then, I think we need to have you back just in general for reasons.
Okay.
All right. Thank you very much. And all of you, stand by. We will be back with more right after this. Don't go anywhere.
You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
And it's a real pleasure for me as a longtime fan to be sitting here with Aaron Gray.
Here with Larry Hama.
We're talking with Kevin J. Anderson, best-selling author.
Mr. Neil Adams.
I am here with David Britt.
Axel Alonso, editor.
Shadow Stevens.
And Devil's Comic-Con with John DeLancey.
With Tom King.
Kevin Conroy.
Denise Crosby.
Pop Con. Pop Expo.
Here on location at Star Wars Celebration.
Expo talking for
our second time with Gil Gerard.
Wichita, Kansas at Time Eddie.
Producer David Gerald.
Yeah, I've got Eric Flint.
Are here at Smallville Comic Con.
Wizard World St. Louis.
LegCon in Bentonville, Arkansas.
Michael Lombardi.
We were talking with Alan Dean.
Quincy Allen.
Suzanne Landon.
Founder of Starlog Magazine. Mr. Kerry Oakwood.
Chris Sami.
Lynn Lee.
Dave Schwartz.
Mano Interravi.
John.
Jason Aaron.
This is Sci-Fi for Me, your portal to the science fiction multiverse. Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Be sure to connect with us on social media and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss our next broadcast. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
Here we go, ladies and gentlemen, in the third hour. Everybody say hi, Todd.
Hi, Todd.
Good to have all of you with us here in this discussion. By the way, you guys can record your own Hi Todd and send it to us, and we'll add it to the mix. Live from the bunker at sci-fi4me.com. Just send me an MP3. You can record it on your phone. Okay, so now we are in our third hour. We've got some other news headlines to get to, but I'm going to go ahead and put the link in the chat for people who want to join. Assuming that anybody wants to join the call, I mean, there it is. So let's do that. We will put that in there and pin that, and we'll put it over there. All right. So you can join the show, ask your questions, spout off your rants. You got good things to say about something, that's fine too. If you have opinions you want to share, you want to scream and yell about something, let's do that. Mrs. Boss, are you ready to talk about Dune Part 2? Because we haven't really done that yet.
I don't know. Are you finished ranting about everything else so we can?
Well, you weren't down here when people were asking you about it. So.
Well, yes, but then I was here and...
Well, that's what I do. I rant, and then we had the professor show up. All right, so let's talk for just a second. Let's talk about Dune Part 2. Cam is making a comment there that you sound a little aggressive.
Me? Wait, wasn't it yesterday you were saying you should give me a period to rant off?
Well, there's another word that goes in front of that aggressive that I think applies sometimes. But I'm going to get in trouble. All right, Doom Part 2. What do you think?
Sorry, I was helping a technician there. I enjoyed it.
And?
Well, okay. So I did enjoy it. I think, I know a lot of people that I spoke to after the first movie came out, they had trouble sitting through it because it was a slow burn. And the thing is that the first movie is setting you up. I mean, it's the beginning of the book. It's the beginning of, you know, a two-parter. So we need to introduce to you where we're at, who we got, what's going on. This movie is what you get after you get that slow burn of introducing the world that has been created here. And I think that it did it well. Big issue I've had for the books that I've read and the movies I've watched is how they don't exactly stick to each other, or too much has changed from the book to fit the format of the movie.
How much of that is, because I didn't notice anything like that just reached out and screamed, this is different from the book. But you've read the book more recently than
I have. No, I'm saying in general. Okay. I have found that with books and movies.
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
It's like Harry Potter. You got to have a few shots before you go see the movie because the movies are crap compared to the books.
Yeah.
You know.
By the way, to Road Vagabond Life's point earlier, Kinnerd. I'm going to keep saying it's Kinnerd. Evidence shows humans didn't kill off Neanderthals. So.
All right.
Point and counterpoint.
So anyway, but the one thing that I will give this, the first movie is what got me into wanting to read the books because it was all of a sudden like, this is kind of cool. And it's always, the Dune books have been one of those, it's scary for me because it's
a dense book and so that's intimidating?
It pretty much. It's why I haven't gotten through Tolkien. Because it gives me a headache every couple paragraphs. And I felt like my brain wasn't smart enough to handle it. But I went ahead and did this. And I'm not saying it was a completely easy read. There's a lot to be take in. But I was able to have the chance to see, then read and read and read all six of the first set of books. And then come back to this. And I can actually see how closely that the book and the movie are together.
Yeah.
Obviously, you're not going to fit everything into, you know, 5 hours. But, I mean, compared to David Lynch's, we could fit a lot more in 5 hours.
Well, and it's one of those things where because we went and saw Lynch's movie in the theater on Sunday when they did the read thing, and I'm watching. This is the first time that I've seen it in gobs of years, and it's your first time ever to see it. And as I'm watching it, I'm thinking to myself, if Lynch had the budget. Relative at the time, I mean, you adjust for inflation and what all of that. But if Lynch had the budget at the time and the resources for, you know, like visual effects and that kind of thing, it could have been a much different movie.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it is very much a David Lynch movie. And I don't know. Because we were talking about this afterwards last night after the press screening. The Lynch movie is very much a product of its time. I mean, it came out in 84. And this is back in the day when Hollywood was not doing part one, part two. I mean, you had trilogies, you know, the Star Wars trilogy and you know, Back to the Future and that kind of thing. But it wasn't expected at the time.
And if it was going to be any longer, it got put as a miniseries.
that, or it was, you know, we'll do what we can do in this self-contained 90-minute to 120-minute film, and if we get a sequel, then maybe we'll do it there. So the mentality of the Hollywood industry was completely different then than it is now. And I don't think, it doesn't matter who it would have been, whether it was David Lynch or anybody else, you would not have been able to do with Dune what Denis Villeneuve is able to do with it now.
Yeah.
Because the thinking in Hollywood has completely changed as far as what kind of stories you can tell and how you can tell them, you know. And really, I don't know how many other directors other than Villeneuve could do just automatically Dune Part 1, Part 2. That's the plan. But you have these movies like the last Harry Potter film that got broken up into Part 1 and Part 2. You have Snyder's Rebel Moon that's been broken up into Part 1 and Part 2. And I'm seeing a trend here that is very worrisome for me. I don't like this idea of Part 1 and Part 2 being part of the plan. Tell the story. And if you can't tell the story in 2 hours, then maybe a film, a feature film, is not the medium for you to do it in. Like you say, back then, we had miniseries on TV, on network television. We had Roots, and we had the Thornbirds, and we had
North and South.
North and South. North and South Book 2, V, all of these. You know, 6 hours, 8 hours to tell the story. They don't do that anymore. Shogun, yeah. Yes, Cam. Shogun. It's something that maybe with streaming going back to advertising tier level things, there's going to have to be some form of incentive to get back to watching those new channels. How do you do that? Maybe the miniseries comes back on these fast channels at some point. I don't know.
Bring the price down.
Yeah, but the Lynch thing, it doesn't age well for me.
But at the same time, you know, there are things, one of my concerns going into this part, or after reading the books, part of my concerns with going into the second half is just how much internal the dialogue and the storytelling is between, you know, Paul and with Jessica and, you know, some of the others. I mean, it was nice that we got the emperor's daughter actually narrating, because she's the one writing the history.
Mm-hmm.
In the diaries and everything. So, there's a lot that is going to be unable to be shown on the screen that you get in books. And, I mean, that's going to be for everything. And with David Lynch's, the internal dialogue over the entire movie, you know, where you're constantly having Paul, what's the connection between all this? What's the connection between all this? I mean, and yes, a lot of that connection, you get some of it now, you get some of it later. I mean, you read everything and you find out how it all works. But anyway, I can go off on that. But anyway, as for the movie, no, they do stick to this book. I am liking the cast better. Because now you're not just being introduced to Gurney. You're not just being introduced to, you know, Paul or Chani or, you know, Jessica. You're actually getting them to see them in their element.
Right.
There is no way Patrick Stewart could have been this Gurney. Or the Gurney that you get in the books, for gosh sakes. The most Gurney that Patrick Stewart could be is when you get to actually have Gurney sing his songs.
Right.
And I'm not saying anything about Josh Brolin singing his songs. I mean, we got Gurney in this, but I think in this you actually get to see who he is. And it'll be interesting to see how that develops for as long as these films go on.
Yeah.
Same with the others. You know, we get to see meet the Emperor now. We get to meet, you know, the Baron's family and actually see what's going on in Getty Prime. And, you know, everything that you're given, all the meat and descriptions that Herbert has in the books, getting to see it, and you're just like, oh, dang. I mean, it is that type of situation. Mm-hmm. It is a beautifully shot film from someone who knows nothing about what's going on behind the curtain. In my original assessment of the first part, I compared the desert to water because that's the way they treated it.
Well, that's how Herbert uses his, you know, the language that Herbert uses in the book. Mm-hmm. Is very much water-based when he's talking about the desert. So it translates into that pretty well.
It does. And, I mean, when you think about where Atreides, you know, are coming from, their home world to here, and the stark flip of the coin, but the same beauty that they were getting from the ocean, from the mist, from the waves, that you see on the dunes, the moving of the sand, the spice, and even with the sandworms in the sand, no different than watching whales play in water, because you get those big splashes of the sand. The sandworms are fun. I mean, you're just sitting there like, yeah, I so want to be a part of this. so that's good. The political thriller that you get in these books, I mean, the pieces were laid in the first movie. We get to see this now play out more. And, you know, for anybody who's read, you know, these books that are how old, you know where that's all going.
Well, for me, I'm watching this visually. It's very impressive, and everybody does a good job. And as I was saying before, a lot of the online chatter about this second half becoming girl boss Chani's story does not happen.
No, it doesn't, because you have to understand that. I mean, first of all, if you know anything about the six books, then you understand how much of a joke that is. Second of all,
well, okay, but to be fair, in this day and age, anything can be changed to be a more feminist girl boss story. I mean,
like
the fact
Candace being her father.
Yeah,
in the
fact
the
that
books.
All of that, the fact that they could change it. Was the source of speculation. You know, everybody was like, well, this becomes Johnny's story. It's not. It's Paul's story. Jessica has her thing to do. Johnny has her thing to do. But this is still very much driven by Paul.
It is very much driven by Paul. And if there's anything about Johnny, it's the fact of how much she is an influence in his life.
Yeah.
And... you know, I'm sitting there waiting for a certain line to happen, but then I have to remember, there's more books. This stops here. And the relationship between her and Jessica and some of the conversations happen later, and I have to remind myself of that. Oh. But it's not as much about... I mean, and trust me, when I was seeing stuff like that, I was like, wait a minute, how, what, no, but there is a, you know, there is a level where she has her role, and she plays her role, but as Jason puts it, it's still very much a boy movie, if you want to sit there and start labeling.
Well... it's Paul's story.
It's Paul's story.
And
at
that
this
doesn't
point.
Necessarily make it a boy movie so much as it stays faithful to the book.
It stays faithful to the book. You've got Paul. You've got Paul fighting other guys. It's like Chani's stepping in and being like,
you could make the argument.
This.
You can make the argument that it's a boys' movie because of all the explosions and the military exercise and that sort of thing. And, you know, the arenas, the fight in the arena. On that, I found it really interesting what they did visually
with the arena
when we introduce Fade. And how they did the lighting and the negative space is basically it's an inversion of light in that space, and I thought that was an interesting creative choice.
I thought so too, because in my mind, even though we have been there before in the early books, when you get into going to that planet in the later books, I mean, the whole world has changed because of what happens on Dune. And that's not the imagery in my head, because I'm sitting here picturing what's going on in book 5 and 6, and I'm not thinking of the way they're visually putting it in book 1 here.
Yeah.
And so that is interesting. I did appreciate Stellan Skarsgård as the Baron more this time around, because, I mean, the dude is so fat, he floats with his stuff, but he's so fat and gargantuan and, you know, kind of like the guy from, you expect him to be eating, I mean, you see him eating in the first film, but you picture the tomato and from Lord of the Rings. Return of the King, when when Pippin is, or Mary, I forget which one, is sitting there and he's supposed to sing and the guy's eating his food and the cherry tomato just pops and rolls all over his face.
Right.
I mean, and that's what you expect of the Baron and then some. And, but this, you get to see him more physically.
Yeah,
and you get to truly appreciate that. As for Florence Pugh playing the princess, I think she did a good job. I was fine with her getting cast, but the way that she is described, yes, she's blonde, but the way she's described as her beauty, I'm not saying that Florence Pugh isn't within that realm, but at the same time, she lacks some of the beauty that is expected from the descriptions in the book. But
who would you have cast?
I'm not quite sure. But you're talking about someone who is the most beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not saying, like I said, I'm not saying anything against her beauty, but I mean, I could sit there and pull it out with the description, but a little different.
Okay.
There's something missing, but I don't know.
Yeah. Now, one negative that I will share, not about the production of the film, not about the actual movie itself. It was about my experience watching it. and Mrs. Boss doesn't quite know where I'm coming from on this. She's like, oh, I didn't get that. Okay, so I'm old. Let's preface with that.
You preface everything with that one,
actually. I have damage in my ears because of time spent in jazz band in college and whatnot. So I'm in here. We're watching it in the IMAX theater, which I don't prefer IMAX. And we're watching it, and we get to the arena where they introduce Fade. And the sound mix on this thing is so atrocious. The sound effects and the music tracks overwhelm dominate everything, and it was so loud in the theater where we were sitting. I felt it physically It was that loud. I felt the sound. And there were times where, I mean, because everybody's speaking different languages. Nobody's speaking English at this point. There are times where if there had not been subtitles, you would not have heard anybody speaking because the sound and the music were so overpowering. It was so annoying. And by the time we got to the last, I don't know, 20 or so minutes, I was angry. I was watching this and I was split. I was like, this is a good movie. I'm enjoying it. It's maybe about 15 minutes too long. But I was also angry about it because I was not able to enjoy it. I can appreciate it, but I couldn't enjoy it because of the physical experience in the space. So, I don't know. It's just me.
But the music is good. It goes well with it.
It's okay. It didn't knock me out. It didn't impress me. It's useful. It's appropriate, but it didn't do anything. It didn't impress upon me its importance to the story the way a John Williams score would, for example.
No, but it complemented it.
Okay.
I think it did. And as for being too long, I think it was fine. I really do. I don't think that it was too long. I think it was just right, honestly. I do recommend, Mr. Boss will agree with me, that because we had talked about it yesterday. But if you're planning on seeing this, take the time to watch the first movie.
Yeah, that will help. That will help. Definitely.
I mean, it's kind of like when you watch Blade Runner and Blade Runner 40, whatever. Even though, you know, they take a place much farther apart than these two movies do, it feeds right into it, down to the music even, extremely much into it. But with this one, to reintroduce yourself to what you're about to sit through in the second half, you know, it's a smart thing to do.
And really, if they had been smart about it, Warner Brothers should have re-released part one in theaters for, like, say, a 3-week run and then come in to release part two. You know, if you're doing March 1st for part two, release part one.
Like last week.
Well, I mean, you could do the last week, you know, first weekend of February, you know, February 1st, and run it for 3 weeks, and then you could go into part two.
You could have done Valentine's Day for it.
Oh, that would have killed Madame Web. I mean, Madame Web.
Okay, Madame Web was dead
well
on
anyway.
Arrival, wasn't
but,
it?
But yeah, but it would have done even worse. Had there been something else in the theaters for it.
Okay,
for
and
you to
it
watch.
Would have been a good show to Marvel that if you have a re-release of a film,
well,
killing
was it.
It.
There was something like that. I can't remember what it was, but it was something like that where something got beat by a re-release or a I can't remember exactly. Road Vagabond says, Lord of the Rings was the last time I waited years between part movies. I will wait till it's done for anything from now on. Well, part the third is, you know, the third movie that Villeneuve is planning is going to be, I think I heard it's going to combine Children of Dune and Dune Messiah, and it'll round out Paul's story. So we do leave it. So it's these two movies are the first book. So it does have an ending, which is a beginning for a new arc. If that makes sense. So you can watch part one and part two, and you don't have to watch anything else past that. What? What?
I just am... There's so much, and the way the stories go, and the especially... I mean, okay, do Messiah, but Children of Dune, that needs to be so separate from it in its own movie. It can't...
Well, okay, Sci-Fi Channel... So the thing is, and I remember the discussion about it when Sci-Fi Channel did it, because Sci-Fi did the same thing. They combined those two stories. And the reasoning that was kicked around at the time was because one of those books is so short. It's a smaller story. It's a shorter story that they end up combining the two in order to have enough material for however much they want to do. And the themes and the elements of those stories combine for
and
reasons.
It does wrap it up, but the Children of Dune sets up the next, if you have someone who is going to do it, it sets up the next three books, because what happens in there, you finally get your explanation.
I would imagine that the thinking behind what Denis Villeneuve is doing as a director, he probably figures I can only get away with three. Because at some point, like, you know, you look at what's happening with the Marvel stuff right now. At some point, you're not going to have enough interest from the audience to continue. And you get the law of diminishing returns. Because the trilogy is the model for a lot of stuff. Thank you, Star Wars. We got, you know, because Star Wars did it. Back to the Future did it. All of these films now are expected to be trilogies or a series. You know, Harry Potter did, what, seven films? And we're up
no,
to how many?
There's seven books.
There's seven
eight
books.
Films.
There's eight films. So you've got the Scream movies. You've got, but see, the traditional model of the trilogy is sequels, not continuation of the same story. So you get to, like Cam saying, Children of Dune is the prologue of the final three of the other three books. What Villeneuve's probably doing is, I can do this arc in three movies. Past that, the studios are probably not going to pay for any more.
Well, and I could sit there and see that because of how different the last books are from the first three.
Yeah.
I mean, that's those in themselves. I mean, that's a whole new ball game.
Well, and it's entirely possible that Villeneuve doesn't even have any interest in telling those stories.
And I can understand that because of it. I can understand that because you would have to have people who are diehards,
yeah,
and wanting to know more. And I get what Cam's saying about the difference, you know, the underratedness of Messiah and where the, you know, Children of Dune are. I get that. I mean, if you're going to end with the, you know, in the story, Paul's story, then, yeah, that's where you got to cut it off. And you don't want, I mean, you can allude to the next three books, but it is very philosophical, the last three. I mean, I don't know how many times I was sending screenshots of things that Leto 2 was saying to, you know, in his dialogue internally or in the diaries or anything like that, that you're just like, oh, that so is relevant now. And, you know, I've alluded to Jason a lot of where the books go. And, I mean, ideally in today's culture, in today's, you know, the way the culture has gone to, you know, we talk about girl power.
Yeah.
Where the last three books would be perfect.
The thing is, you also have to take into account that these movies are made for two different audiences. Any adaptation like Lord of the Rings or the Marvel, the DC movies, the Harry Potter movies, Twilight, Dune, any of the movies that are adapting some other source material, you have two different audiences. You have the very entrenched, esoteric, niche audience of the people who were the original fans of the original material, the people who read the books. And then you have the general audience who has absolutely no idea what any of this stuff is. And so you get through to the end of the third movie, and you have to do it in a way that brings it to a conclusion, because not everybody is going to know where it's going after that. Not everybody is going to know the depth of the Bene Gesserit and all that other stuff. I mean, you still have Sisterhood of Dune that's coming, the TV series.
Is that still
coming? It's still a thing. So that's coming. What we need to do, and you and I talked about this yesterday, I need to send an email to Kevin Anderson.
I'll take credit for this idea.
And invite him and Brian Herbert to join us on the program to talk about it. And we'll try to set this up after the movie comes out so people have time to see it. Maybe we'll try for that first or second week of March after the movie drops and have Brian and Kevin on here to talk about where it goes after this. So that's an email I'll be sending out today.
Well, and that's, you know, that's something, you know, because after I had read the books and then they had announced that they were doing the Sisterhood of Dune, which is about the Bene Gesserit, and doing more research and finding out that there's the three books that talk about the three different schools that are, you know, one for them, one for the navigators, and one for the Mentats.
Yeah.
Mentats. And I'm like, I want to read this. But there's like seven books in between the last Dune, the sixth book, and the beginning, the Sisterhood. And I was like, what do I absolutely have to read?
Because we asked Kevin.
No, we did ask Kevin. And he said that I could, he said to read the second trilogy, which is about the war, because of the history and the knowledge you need from that. But the first three books you can skip, which is one on the House of Atreides, one on the House of Carino, I think, and one on the House of Harkin. So it's going through their history stories. And then there's one other random one, and I forget what that one's called. But you could skip those, but go to the next three, which are about the war, then you can jump into that.
Yeah, Cam saying that the prequels are way more suited for a movie, probably. here is, speaking of Madam Web, Ben Temple Smith, who is a comic book artist, he's posted breaking news over on Twitter. He says, breaking news, I just heard Madam Web has now made enough money to buy the producers of Starbucks coffee each.
That's good.
Oh, we are full of humor today. Cam, the second trilogy with the Wayback history. That's the second trilogy from Kevin and Brian.
Cam, do not give them any ideas.
What? There's nothing wrong.
No. Hollywood.
Well,
don't give them any ideas.
We'll see. But I think this one's going to do okay. It's probably not, I mean, it's not going to make a billion. Have we heard the budget on this? Do we know what the budget is?
I don't know what the budget is, but you're going to have to you're going to have to find the people who kind of enjoyed the first movie, but were just kind of like my mom or my cousin, or, you know, they were like, oh, it was, you know, waiting for something. Yeah. It was slow. It
says here production budget is $190 million. So it needs to make it needs to clear north of 800 to 900 million in order to start looking good in the box office. Weatherman joining us. Hello, good to see you. I say north of 800. It probably needs to. It doesn't necessarily have to hit a billion. I know they'd be happy with that. But with a production budget of 190, I think you figure probably their marketing is going to be another 150, maybe. So it's going to need to, yeah, it's going to need to clear north of 900 million in order to be considered a success, at least. So we'll see. E. Clay Thomason joining us in the chat as well, saying hi. Good to see you as well. If you are just joining us for our Harry Turtledove chat, then you go back an hour and a half now, an hour and 40 minutes now, and hit replay, and you will find that conversation. And, you know, as much as I was a little nervous, I will admit to being a little bit nervous, because it's Harry Turtledove, and Harry Turtledove is rather popular in our circles. So, but I think it went pretty well. I think that conversation went really well. He thought it went fine. He enjoyed it. So that's always a plus. So we'll see. Anybody wants to join in and jump in this conversation, you are more than welcome to. The link is pinned to the top of the chat widget. Otherwise, we'll go and take off so I can work in the garden. E. Clay says, just caught up. Great interview. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. As much as I do with all of the different things that I do, the older I get, this is my thing, I think. I think I'm finally getting to the point where I'm realizing that this is my thing to be the Larry King of science fiction podcasts.
Does that mean we get suspenders and a tie?
Well, maybe not suspenders. Maybe not Larry King. I mean, well, I have always described this program as a if you take Larry King Live and Inside the Actor's Studio and you mash them up, you put a science fiction filter on it, that's kind of where we are. And I always enjoy having conversations with other people because it's more interesting to have them talk instead of just me. So, but I think I have found my niche. Now we just got to figure out a way to make money doing it. Right? Speaking of which, we do have Super Chats. We are monetized if anybody wants to drop a Super Chat. And we still have the Subscribestar account. I haven't done anything with it. It's still active. But nobody is under any obligation whatsoever to give us money. I don't think this is a viable plan now. Road Vagabond Life says you need to get young, you need to keep getting younger and younger wives to be Larry King.
Wasn't he married to? No, that was.
I'm happy with the one I've got. I will die with this one. Not that this one's gonna kill me, but. I will die with this one. I will die happy.
He is working in the garden. He just doesn't know what he's working on.
Yeah. Bury him vertical, people. Just remember, bury him vertical.
Bury him vertical and plant rare flowers around it. That way they can't dig it up because it's considered...
Protected species? Protected life? Yeah. Yeah. By the way, we need to throw some more dirt out there in the back. I've got a couple of things that I need to do.
Don't worry, as you dig that hole.
I know. Yeah. Okay. Right. Yeah. All right. Well, I think we're gonna call it. That will be it for today. And tomorrow on the program, we will have as our guest, Christopher Rocchio. He has just moved to Bay and Books for his next Sun Eaters novel. And so we'll be talking about that. I think it's coming out. The next one, I think, is coming out in May. So we will be talking about that. We'll talk about his writing process and whatnot. and do that. And then, of course, on Friday, probably we'll do a little bit of open line, but I'm hoping to get some people together for a panel on the Hugos and see what happens there. Tina Guzman in the chat. Tina, good to see you. Tina, do I usually see Tina's name over on Odyssey or Rumble? I don't know that I've seen that on YouTube before. Maybe it's just me. Maybe I'm getting old. All right, that's it for us. All the different places where you can find us, the different video channels and the social media channels and the platforms and the whatnot and the newsletter and the Discord. Do go sign up and join us over there for those conversations. And we'll be back to do this all again tomorrow, 1 p.m. Eastern, live. And you can also listen to this as a podcast if you want. Share the links. Leave a thumbs up on your way out. And remember, the politicians hate you. The media lies to you. But God has a plan for you. And there are four lights.
This has been a presentation of Sci-Fi for Me TV. Copyright 2024 by Flaming Dog Media, LLC. All rights reserved. No portion of this program may be retransmitted without the express written consent of Flaming Dog Media. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV.